Okay, this will be part three, looking at contributions to low-level moisture. And in this case, we've considered already the air mass modification and return flow cycle, the effects of inland mixing once the moisture returns to the continent. And in this case, this is more of a warm season process where we look at the role of evapotranspiration. Okay, when we're talking evapotranspiration, we need several factors to be in place. And this is stuff that you will observe in the days or weeks preceding the cases where evapotranspiration boosts low-level moisture. Typically, it'll be a wet period preceding this so that we have plenty of soil moisture, crops are healthy and growing, or trees and grasses and sort of things are green, they're healthy, they're transpiring. And then also we have to consider the vertical profile. We need an elevated mixed layer or something to cap the boundary layer so that the moisture that we're adding during the day is not just getting redistributed in the vertical through the mixing process. And we almost always start with some blob of higher dew point air that you can trace back to the ocean source to begin with. And we just add on top of that. So we'll look at a case where this is pretty typical, nothing terribly special about this. Notice it's in August is what we're looking at. It's typically we're looking from June and beyond to have evapotranspiration be a big deal. We're focusing up on Iowa, Minnesota. Notice the drought conditions are down in the southern plains, but up here in the upper Midwest, relatively moist. There's a few slightly drier areas there in northeast Iowa, but in general, no severe drought conditions. So we'll look at the, I'll show you the observations with satellite, and then we'll go to the mesoanalysis plots that'll make it easier to show you how the moisture changed during the day. These are the surface observations, and just focus on the dew points, the lower numbers at all the station plots. Generally, the greens are in the 60s and the yellows are in the 70s Fahrenheit. This is in the morning, then we get like midday, and then in the evening, we had some thunderstorms that produced some severe weather in Minnesota. But if you can read the numbers, the dew points near the surface come up from the morning. They are sitting in the 60s in southeast, or near 70 in southeast Minnesota, near 70 in Iowa. By late afternoon, we have dew points in the middle 70s Fahrenheit. And so this isn't a case where it's necessarily you can just point to upstream moisture advection. This is through local contributions from widespread mature corn crop and sufficient soil moisture. So what this looks like when we just strip it down to the color fill of the dew points, the yellows correspond to the same thing, so low 70s in the yellow colors. If you just focus on that, this is in the morning, midday, evening. So you see the dew points come up uniform almost everywhere within the warm sector. And this is a response to added moisture to the boundary layer from below and sheltering this from deep mixing compared to the case that we showed in the central plains in April. So keep in mind, this is an August case. It's not just because it's August doesn't mean that it's going to be hotter and the vertical mixing is going to be deeper. Just because it's later in the summer, you have to consider the actual vertical profiles. Okay, so here's the sounding in Davenport in the morning. This is a sort of profile. It shallow, cool layer. There was perhaps a very weak boundary left over from the prior day. Moisture actually increases with height. So in this case, if you introduce some surface heating and mixing, the dew points might actually increase initially by mixing down the moisture, this little spike in the moist layer just above the top of the boundary layer. And what happens is you look at Davenport, there was some of that, but also the skin layer dew point comes up. Some of this might be an artifact of the sounding, the observation characteristics there. That little decrease in the dew point is potentially real because we have a little inversion in the evening, but the point is you see the moist layer did increase, but notice the height of the mix layer, which is the striadiabatic layer. It doesn't go very high, so the mixing is not deep in this profile. So we're able to, whatever moisture we add in the boundary layer stays in the boundary layer during the afternoon. Same kind of thing over in Lincoln, Illinois. Notice the moisture increases with height, so that's a signal that if we get mixing through that depth, we'll actually bring moisture air down to the ground. And then when you consider the addition of the crop moisture, we've created very large buoyancy. Some of the biggest CAPE values you'll see in the contiguous United States are going to be in these circumstances. This one, I think, was 6,000 or 7,000 CAPE for the most unstable parcel, and with a surface dew point of 79 Fahrenheit. So these are very high dew points, typical of late summer. But you notice, compared to that Oklahoma-Kansas case, the mixed layer is relatively shallow. So anything that we're adding during the day through the transpiring crops and evaporation from the relatively moist ground is staying in the boundary layer across the whole region. Okay, so the key here, though, is this doesn't show up in one day. You don't just see these upper 70 dew points in one day. It usually takes on the order of 3 to 5 days to see this whole pattern evolve. And I'm going to show you a 5-day lead up to this event. So this is every 24 hours, the SPC mesoanalysis plots. Notice that we'll just focus on the low 70 dew points and the yellows. So I've just sketched in loosely the frontal zone. So there's an old front with a weather system that's lifting north. The next day we see the increase in the moisture. But if you notice from day to day, the overall dew points, we have the similar quality of moisture just hanging around each afternoon. And what's happening is that eventually this lifts up to the north, and here we are at the time of our event, where we've basically had this blob of air that's just kind of wobbling around the Midwest. You notice over multiple days, it doesn't tend to go much of anywhere. So it's accumulating moisture slowly. So the moisture source, while it is substantial, a cornfield is nowhere near as efficient as 85 degree ocean, which is pure water. The corn can add quite a bit to the moist layer, but it's takes many days, and this has to accumulate over quite a bit of time. So these events don't just sneak up on you. They're not going to show up in one day. You should see this develop easily over the course of a week. Okay, so just summarizing that, the evapotranspiration, the vertical moisture structure matters. So does the structure of vertical mixing, which is related to the height of the and strength of the cap. We've got to keep the moisture in that shallow layer. And then do we have moisture sources regionally or locally, and where we have something to add moisture to the boundary layer during the day when the crops are active.